Let's open our Bibles to Ephesians chapter 5. We're going to pick up our study in verse 22 this morning. We left off at verse 21 last Sunday. If you're new with us, we just go straight through God's Word. And so you always know where we're going to pick up on the next Sunday, and you can be in the book of Ephesians. So let's go to the Lord in prayer for our time in Bible study and be preparing our hearts for communion. Lord, we just place ourselves on the altar here this morning with the subject matter. We know that it's so important to you and so incredibly meaningful for the life of the church and for the purpose of the church and for the purpose of marriage within the confines of the church, Lord. And we also pray, Father, for this very vital aspect of our lives to be a testimony to the lost world that you intend for it to be. And Father, as we look into these things more deeply, we know that there are depths that we can't even begin to plumb when it pertains to this subject matter. And yet, Lord, we boldly and wonderfully, I think, present exactly what your word says this morning. And Father, we just pray that your Holy Spirit would plumb those depths in our hearts that cannot be reached by the voice of man. Even the printed page, Lord, fails to access sometimes the heart, the depth of the heart that your Holy Spirit can really look into, Father. Even the deepest recesses in our hearts, Lord, we offer to you for your illumination this morning, as we spoke last week about the light bringing that revelation, that divine inspiration, Father, to our lives. And so, Lord, we pray that you would have your way in us this morning according to this subject, this text, this topic. And we ask these things in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, we begin reading, wives, submit to your own husbands as to the Lord. For the husband is the head of the wife, as also Christ is the head of the church, and he is Savior of the body. Therefore, just as the church is subject to Christ, so let wives be to their own husbands in everything. Husbands, love your wives, just as Christ also loved the church and gave himself for her, that he might sanctify and cleanse her with the washing of water by the word, that he might present her to himself, a glorious church, not having spot or wrinkle or any such thing, but that she should be holy and without blemish. So husbands ought to love their own wives as their own bodies. He who loves his wife loves himself. For no one ever hated his own flesh, but nourishes and cherishes it just as the Lord does the church. For we are members of his body, of his flesh, and of his bones. For this reason, a man shall leave his father and mother and be joined to his wife, and the two shall become one flesh. This is a great mystery, but I speak concerning Christ and the church. Nevertheless, let each one of you in particular so love his own wife as himself, and let the wife see that she respects her husband. Context means everything, doesn't it? We say that all the time around here, but especially when we come to this particular passage, Ephesians chapter 5, verses 22 through 33, we understand the necessity of placing this text in its proper context. And the proper context of Ephesians chapter 5, verses 22 through 33 comes after Ephesians chapters 1 through 3, where we find out all that we have received as born-again believers in the moment that we pray to be born again in Christ Jesus, in the moment that we are saved. We receive everything that we need from the Lord. We are given the Holy Spirit. We are given the grace. We are given the mercy. We are given a holy inheritance that we outline. Paul deliberately pointing out all that we have received in Christ, and he used that phrase, in Christ, in Christ, in Christ, in Christ, throughout the first three chapters. And then when we come to chapter 4 through chapter 5, verse 14, we see the encouragement to now walk. We see the encouragement now to apply what we have received. We have received this grace. We have received this mercy. We have received this power of the Holy Spirit. What will we do with it? Paul encourages us in chapter 4, begins to delineate how we are to walk as a result of that encouragement in chapter 5. And then when we get to the 15th verse of chapter 5, we read this: see then that you walk circumspectly, not as fools, but as wise, redeeming the time because the days are evil. Therefore, do not be unwise, but understand what the will of the Lord is. And do not be drunk with wine, in which is dissipation or waste, but be filled with the Spirit, speaking to one another in psalms and hymns and spiritual songs, singing and making melody in your heart to the Lord, giving thanks always for all things to God the Father in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ, submitting to one another in the fear of God. And so right away, when we get to verse 22 of chapter 5, we can ask ourselves this question leading into this verse: what does being filled with the Holy Spirit produce? And from this point on, Paul, and really the Holy Spirit employing Paul as the author of this word, it is Holy Scripture. From this point on, really the Holy Spirit directly addresses wives in verse 22. These are definite articles. Wives in verse 22, husbands in verse 25, children in chapter 6, verse 1 that we'll get to next week, bondservants in chapter 6, verse 5, and masters in chapter 6, verse 9. So the flow, the emanation of being filled with the Spirit now affects lives, and these are the lives that we're talking about. When we talk about bondservants, we're really talking about employees, aren't we? When we talk about masters, we're really talking about employers or supervisors or managers or presidents or kings or rulers, however you want to put that. And in each condition of life, what is the message of the Holy Spirit? What is the conviction of the Holy Spirit for that life? What will a born-again life, those who are filled with the Holy Spirit, what will a born-again life look like in that life role? And stipulating when Jesus is Lord, underscore is in that stipulation. And Paul begins with marriage because it is the essential relationship of mankind. And we go all the way back to the book of Genesis in chapter 2, and I hope that you're already well familiar with this subject matter and these texts that are going to be brought out this morning. And we go all the way back to Genesis chapter 2, the second chapter in God's Word, beginning at verse 18. And we note in verse 18, the Lord God said, Genesis chapter 2, verse 18, and the Lord God said, it is not good that man should be alone. That's notable because that's the first thing in God's word that God says is not good. Up until that point, everything that God has created, he has said about his creation, it is good, it is very good. He is well pleased. But when it comes to Adam, the first man, being alone, God says that that's not good. And so we see there is a need created. And so we read on, it is not good that man should be alone. I will make him a helper comparable to him. Out of the ground, the Lord God formed every beast of the field and every bird of the air and brought them to Adam to see what he would call them. So he's now going to produce a desire in Adam to have a helpmeet in the same way that each of the animals do that are coming to him by pairs. So he brought them to Adam to see what he would call them. What a privilege. And whatever Adam called each living creature, that was its name. So Adam gave names to all cattle, to the birds of the air, and to every beast of the field. But for Adam, there was not found a helper comparable to him. And the Lord God caused a deep sleep to fall on Adam, and he slept. And he took one of his ribs and closed up the flesh in its place. Then the rib which the Lord God had taken from man, he made into a woman, and he brought her to the man. And Adam said, continuing on in this notion that he's naming the creatures that God brings to him, Adam said, this is now bone of my bones and flesh of my flesh. She shall be called woman, because she was taken out of man. Therefore, a man shall leave his father and mother and be joined to his wife, and they shall become one flesh. Now, I would have you note the position of that verse. This is God's creation of marriage. This is God's invention of marriage. God is the creator of marriage. God is the inventor of marriage. And it is pre-fall. It's the only thing that we have that has come forward relationship-wise that remains, that is pre-fall. We also note God created woman for the man, from the man. And we note that God created marriage between one man and one woman, for man and for woman, and for children. You get to Malachi chapter 2, verse 15, we see that God desires godly offspring. So God is using one man and one woman of his creation in order to populate the kingdom of heaven for all eternity with godly children. So one man and one woman, for man and for woman and for children for life. For life. And we see that in Matthew's Gospel, chapter 19, when Jesus was discussing marriage. And he looks all the way back to the garden. And some of you, again, very familiar with this passage. The Pharisees came to him, testing him, and they were testing him in this area of divorce, separation. And he answered and said to them, "Have you not read what he who made them at the beginning made them, male and female?" And he said, for this reason, he quotes from Genesis chapter 2, verse 24, which Paul also likewise quotes in Ephesians chapter 5 this morning. And he said, for this reason, a man shall leave his father and mother and be joined to his wife, and the two shall become one flesh. And then he said, so then, they are no longer two, but one flesh. Therefore, what the Lord has joined together. And it's a very long Greek word there, that idea of being joined together. And the only place that word is employed in the New Testament, I'll let you look it up on your own later on. I can't really pronounce this one. It means yoked. It means conjoined. And conjoined is a stronger word than just joined. Conjoined implies something on the order of a weld. And if you're familiar with the process of welding, then you know that a weld between two pieces of metal is actually stronger than the metal itself. And this is what God desires for marriage. Therefore, what God, notice the emphasis, God has joined together, not man. God has joined one man and one woman together in marriage. And so let not man separate that relationship. And there the Greek word is charizo, which I can pronounce, and it literally means divide. Let not any man divide that relationship. And so going back to Ephesians chapter 5, we understand that this discussion in Ephesians chapter 5, verses 22 through 33, pertains strictly to a born-again man joined in marriage to a born-again woman. And we are talking about those who are spirit-filled, as we have read the encouragement, even the exhortation in verse 18, be filled with the Holy Spirit. That's what believers are to do. That's what believers are to be. They are to be being filled, constantly filled with the Holy Spirit. And when they are filled with the Holy Spirit, that has an impact, that has an effect. And we note that part of the effect of being filled with the Holy Spirit, who is, after all, the Spirit of Jesus Christ, our Lord, we note that Jesus is at the very center of that marriage where one born-again man and one born-again woman are being filled with the Holy Spirit. And we see that in verses 19 through 21, the outflow of that, the outcome of that, speaking to one another in psalms and hymns and spiritual songs, singing and making melody in your heart to the Lord, giving thanks always for all things to God the Father in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ, who is at the very center of that relationship, submitting to one another in the fear of God, in the reverence of God. So we note that Jesus is at the very center of that marriage, the kind of marriage that we're describing here this morning, the born-again Christian marriage that Paul is discussing here, and that marriage between one born-again man And one born-again woman is intended by God to represent, to typify, to illustrate, to be a picture of God's relationship with his church. And that's what we see in verse 32. Paul alluding to the fact this is a great mystery. It doesn't mean that it's a mystery that cannot be found out. It means that it is a mystery that is being revealed presently. And the mystery that's being revealed presently is that God ordained all this. God established all this. God designed all this for a specific purpose that he had in mind, and that was to represent the relationship between Jesus Christ and his church. Jesus Christ and the church. We see that in verse 32. And that is the supreme God-intended goal for marriage. How then, we might ask, can that lofty goal be accomplished, especially since we know marriage is the union in Christ of two very accomplished sinners, even those who are born again, very accomplished, very practiced in sin? Well, the answer to that is each of these two very accomplished sinners have a very specific God-given role to play. Secondarily, each role is unique, and each has a very specific purpose. And thirdly, each role is equally important in accomplishing God's purpose for marriage, which we have just seen in verse 32. That marriage, that Christian marriage, that one born-again man married to one born-again woman would be a picture or an illustration, an example of the relationship between Jesus Christ and the church. A couple things that we can mention just informationally. I don't know if any of you struggle with the idea of believing in a literal Adam and Eve, but we remember that what Jesus was talking about in Matthew's Gospel chapter 19 when he was speaking about, you know, what God has joined together, let not man separate, that he was referring back to Genesis chapter 2 verse 24, have you not read? Jesus Christ himself believes in Adam and Eve. And Jesus Christ himself believes in the literal creation sequence of events that are described exactly in the book of Genesis. Now, that might be difficult for some of you more scientific, supposedly materialists to grasp, but we place our faith in Christ and not in man looking at the same evidence and finding a different conclusion. I'm gonna agree with what Jesus Christ said about that situation. We also note Jesus described marriage as being between one man and one woman. Now, we are talking about a born-again man, and we are talking about a born-again woman, but the resemblance of that outside the church that takes place civilly or legally that has also been part of the underpinning of our society, that's God's design for marriage. One man and one woman. And that is unmistakable. And so God, to the born-again believer, man, woman, God provides very simple rules for the roles we are to play, which are simply impossible to accomplish apart from the Spirit of Jesus Christ being at the very center of the marriage. And the first demonstration to the world this marriage is hopeless and helpless apart from Christ. In Christian marriage, we well know, Christian marriage is as much a struggle against the flesh and its carnal desires and emotions as worldly marriage is. Only we have, Ephesians chapter 1 through Ephesians chapter 3, only we possess the hope of glory and the power of unconditional love and forgiveness authored by Jesus Christ at the very center of our lives, residing in our hearts. And the Word of God as instruction for our lives. And again, reminding each of us, read over Ephesians chapter 1 through Ephesians chapter 3. We already have that on account. It's like if you look at it, if you possessed all the money that existed in all of the world, and somebody presented you with a debt that you owed, it wouldn't matter how great that debt was, you'd be able to pay it because you already possess all the money that exists in all of the world. And so there is no debt that you owe that cannot be paid through the power of Christ and the inheritance of Christ and the love of Christ and the grace of Christ that we already, in the very moment that we pray to receive Christ as our Savior, in the very moment that we are born again of God, all of that comes into our possession. All of that is freely given to us by God, and that is the great wonder and the awesome story that unfolds for us in Ephesians chapter 1 through chapter 3. And I would encourage each of you to familiarize yourselves with all of that that has been placed in your account. And now begin to live as if you had that in your possession, because you do. And it's received by faith. And it's walked out by faith. And it's also walked out in the truth of that understanding. Christian marriage isn't perfect. It is being perfected constantly. But then, thinking about the illustration that God has in mind for Christian marriage, so is the church being perfected constantly in its relationship to Christ. And while perfection may be a lofty goal, it is the only goal worth aiming for. And we already have it, don't we? It's an interesting thought, an interesting concept. Born-again believers probably wrestle with this in this conversation that we have with the Spirit. We are both longing for perfection and also possessing perfection at the same time. And the way that we possess perfection is that when God looks at us, he sees us in Christ. And the blood of Jesus washes away the sin of every man. That was the work that was accomplished on the cross. The blood of Jesus washes away the sin of every man. And so God sees you as already perfect, even as you are being perfected. And this is the hope of glory that we have in Christ. And so all that said, we come to the role of the wife in verses 22 through 24, stipulating that this is laid out as God's instruction for the born-again wife, the born-again woman who is married. And we see the wife is to play the subordinate or supporting role. And we remember each, the husband and the wife, each have roles to play within the God-given marriage, the God-ordained marriage, the God-designed marriage, to be an illustration of Christ's relationship to his church. That in mind, the wife is to play the role of the subordinate or the supporting role. And we remember from Genesis chapter 2, verse 18, we have this idea presented that the man, Adam, was alone, and it was not good for man to be alone. And so God created a helper for him. And God created a helper for him from him, taking out of a portion of his side, rendered a rib in the English language. In the Hebrew, it just says a part of his side, a part of him. And so the woman was specifically designed by God for this supporting role, to be a helper, if you will. And reminding ourselves that marriage itself is pre-fall. When we talk about the fall, we're talking about the fall of man. When man turned away from God and turned toward the world, when man chose his own devices and his own plans and his own designs over the plans and the designs of God. Marriage itself is pre-fall. Our God-given roles, whether we are man or woman, husband or wife, our God-given roles in marriage are post-fall. So these stipulations, these plans, only came into being following the fall of man in Genesis chapter 3. And for the woman in this post-fall role, we see in Genesis chapter 3, verse 16, in what is known of as the curse, in Genesis chapter 3, verse 16, after God gave the first rendering of the gospel in verse 15, which is known of as the proto-evangelicum, to the woman, he said, I will greatly multiply your sorrow and your conception. In pain you shall bring forth children. Your desire shall be for your husband, and he shall rule over you. That's the post-fall command, instruction given by God to the woman. Now, that employment in English, that rendering in English, is not quite as clear as the Hebrew meaning that's laid out there, but when it says that your desire shall be for your husband, it means that your desire will be to rule over your husband. Your desire, your innate desire, the desire of your flesh, your emotions, your soul will be to rule over your husband. But God says, hey, I'm going to move contrary to that, and he shall rule over you. And that presents a difficulty, doesn't it? And the reason that God has laid that out, I think, is because what Eve expressed through the temptation that was offered to her and falling prey to that temptation, one command was given to them. Of the fruit of the tree of the knowledge of good and evil, you shall not eat. In the moment you eat of it, you shall die. One command. And so in denying that one command, in going contrary to that one command that had been given by God to the man and to the woman, in the woman's heart there was a denial of favor. And that's what Satan employed to tempt her. You're missing out on something here. You don't have it as good as you could have it if you only ate this fruit. And we don't know what the fruit was. It's not explained. If you only ate this fruit, you could be the God of your own life. You could be the ruler of your own life. You don't need to depend on God. He's holding out on you. You could have much more than God is making available to you if you would only eat of this fruit. So there was a denial of favor in the moment that she fell prey to the temptation that Satan was offering her, and we could teach a whole message on that. There was also a denial of fault following that, in the sense that when God came and said, who told you that you could eat the fruit? There was a denial of fault. There was a denial of blame. There was a denial of having broken that singular commandment, that singular law of God in that time. She said, the serpent made me eat it. Denial of blame. And when we think about this idea of submission that is presented to us in chapter 5 of the book of Ephesians, submission to your husband, and let me stipulate, submission to your husband who is submitted to Christ, and when you see that ordering, you understand that submission to your husband is being submitted to Christ, and not being submitted to your husband is not being submitted to Christ. Submission, think about this, only reveals itself in a disagreement or a dispute. And this is indeed a very great challenge to our post-fall flesh. If it was a challenge to our pre-fall flesh in the example that we have of Adam and Eve, think about the challenge that it is to our post-fall flesh. And when I say that submission, being subordinate, only reveals itself in a disagreement or a dispute, what I mean by that is It is never revealed when there is agreement. An example might be godly man, godly wife, godly husband, godly wife. The godly wife wakes up and says, you know what? I want to come to church 30 minutes early this morning so that you and I can go into the sanctuary and pray. And husband says, I want to go in 35 minutes early so that we can sit in the sanctuary and pray for the service. Pray that people would be saved. Pray for the worship team. Pray for the pastor. Pray for the word of God to be heard and known in every heart. Pray for that engagement and the power of the Holy Spirit. There's a lot to pray for. And when husband and wife are both agreeing and they're vying for how well they can agree with each other, there's no submission required. There's an excitement. There's a joy in the heading in the same direction. But when the wife says, I want to get up early enough so that we can go to church 30 minutes early and sit in the sanctuary and pray, and the husband says, well, you know, I like that idea, but let's go in the EC and spend that 30 minutes in fellowship. Now there's a disagreement. And so there is an opportunity for the wife to submit to the husband, understanding that, and this is what really needs to be understood, it is a qualified submission, and the qualifying of that submission is that it is only to be as to the Lord. Do you see that in verse 22? Wives, submit to your own husbands as to the Lord. Now that has two intended meanings. In one sense, that you are indeed submitting to the Lord. But another rendering of that, another understanding of that, is that you are submitting to that which is godly. You are not required to submit to your husband in ungodly practices, ungodly events, ungodly plans. You are to submit according to this when it comes to that which pertains to Christ, when it comes to that which pertains to godliness and holiness. And there can be differing opinions about things like which church to attend, which service to attend in that church. Do you go Sunday and Wednesday? Do you go Sunday and Wednesday and to a holy home fellowship? Do you come to Sunday night prayer meeting? So there is an opportunity for godliness, but there can be different expressions of that as the Holy Spirit would lead. And so the submission that we see here is a qualified submission. You are not to submit to your husband in ungodly thinking. You are not to submit to your husband in ungodly actions. Things that you know that are expressly forbidden in the Word of God. There is no compulsion upon you placed by the Holy Spirit to submit to criminal activity or to submit to ungodly activity or to submit to dishonest activity. Don't tell those people about the problems with our house while we're in the midst of selling it. That kind of thing. There is no burden placed upon you by the Word of God to submit to dishonesty or lack of integrity. But when things are working in the direction of the Lord Jesus Christ, maturity levels being different, whatever they may be, God has said it that the husband would be the head because of the picture that is being played out. And obedience to Christ's command that we see here in verse 22, obedience to Christ's command to submit, even when you think yourself superior, and that's really where the problem arises, isn't it? And it may in fact be the case that you are superior in your intellect or in your spirituality in that moment. In that time of decision, when a decision is being made in which there's a disagreement or a dispute, and hopefully a loving disagreement or a loving dispute. There's nothing about those words that implies anger or destructive behavior. Differences of opinion being what they are, differences of spiritual opinion being what they are. Obedience to Christ's command to submit, even when you think yourself superior, even when you know yourself superior. It's like what he says in verse 24, just as the church is subject to Christ. Do you see the church being subject to Christ in all things? I don't. There are many, many areas in the life of the church where people in the church, people that populate the church, think themselves superior to what the Word of God says, and they will not go along with what the Word of God says. And one of those areas might just be God's design for marriage. Eh? So the wife is to submit her, the godly wife, the born-again wife, is to submit herself to the godly husband, the born-again husband, just as the body of Christ is to submit itself to Christ in all things. What about those areas where Christ challenges you? How about unforgiveness? Do you have unforgiveness toward anyone? Can you, if you do an inventory in your mind and heart right now, is there anyone that you have unforgiveness toward? Because Jesus doesn't allow that. Jesus commands us to forgive. And to be forgiving most of all toward those who don't deserve it. Why? Because we've been forgiven. And we don't deserve forgiveness. And so we are to take that forgiveness that we've received and apply it to other people. Or maybe it's just marriage. Does it blow your mind that in these last days that our society, our culture has begun to redefine marriage and taken it to be a man and a man or a woman and a woman or whatever they desire it to be, understanding this concept of love and yet not understanding it at all and going completely contrary to what the Word of God says and you being drawn by the sort of soulishness of that and the understanding of you know, the employment of the love of Jesus Christ for all men, even those that would be engaged in homosexual marriage, or all women, even those that would be engaged in homosexual marriage, and now leaving God's description of marriage behind between one man and one woman, and saying, well, I don't see why that has to be. I think marriage could be this. Even though God has said it must be that. And unfortunately, that's what we see. I wish it wasn't. It breaks my heart. Because in this day and age, man, through his own determination, through his own sense that, through his own denial of God's favor upon marriage, has set out on their own course. And, you know, the attack on marriage has been there forever. But now they're really getting at the foundation of it. And since it is the fundamental building block of all culture and all civilization, it might be wise to consider these areas where the church refuses to submit to the headship of Christ because, why? Because it's unpopular. And we perceive unpopularity, and we don't want to be perceived as being unpopular. So we go along to get along. And every fiber of our fleshly being wants to go along to get along. It's the same thing in marriage. Now, your degree, wife, Christian wife, your degree of obedience to Christ's command is measured by the conviction of the Holy Spirit. Because again, with the Holy Spirit involved, any time there is any departure by even the minutest amount from what God's plan is here for Christian marriage that we read here in Ephesians chapter 5, when there is any departure in your heart or in your mind from that plan, from that intent, the Holy Spirit begins to convict. And he would bring you back into alignment with God's plan. So we sense the conviction of the Holy Spirit. Those who are born again, And so our obedience to God's command is always measured by the conviction of the Holy Spirit, and in this case, by the respect, which we see in verse 33, by the respect your husband senses from you. And this is something that I think is quite fascinating that must be brought into this discussion, and that is that the respect that your husband senses from you, wife, produces the unconditionally loving response that you desire. And God knows your frame. God knows your emotional makeup. And men and women are different. Women are a subset of men. They are not the same. This idea of transgenderism, I know, very popular, right? Very cool, very trendy. You can get on the cover of Sports Illustrated magazine and be the woman of the year or whatever it is. Very popular, the idea. Why not? Because every cell in your body, in the case of a man, has the XY chromosome. And that's what determines who you are. And every cell in the body of a woman has the XX chromosome. And that's what determines who you are. You are not free to determine your sex or your gender. And all this is just, it's confusion, it's fog that is brought in. And to stand outside that fog is to make yourself unpopular. Unhip, uncool, judgmental, whatever they want to employ against you, but it is also this, it's truthful. And this degree of respect that your husband perceives from you, wife, Christian wife, that your Christian husband perceives from you, produces in him, and God knows this about him, it produces in him the unconditionally loving response that you desire, which translates itself into the security that you seek in marriage relationships.